The top of the pyramid, the Rothschilds, the Vatican and the British Crown rule the world. There are two operant crowns in England, one being Queen. Although extremely wealthy, the Queen functions largely in a ceremonial capacity and serves to deflect attention away from the other crown, who issues her marching orders through their control of the English Parliament. This other crown is comprised of a committee of 12 banks headed by the Bank of England, also known as the House of Rothschilds. They rule the world from the 677-acre, independent sovereign state known as the City of London, or simply the City. The City is not a part of England, just as Washington, D.C., is not a part of the USA. The City is referred to as the wealthiest square mile on Earth and is presided over by a Lord Mayor who is appointed annually. When the Queen wishes to conduct business within the City, she is met by the Lord Mayor at Temple, Templar, Bar, where she requests permission to enter this private, sovereign state. She then proceeds into the City walking several paces behind the Mayor. Her entourage may not be clothed in anything other than service uniforms. In the 19th century, 90% of the world's trade was carried by British ships controlled by the Crown. The other 10% of ships had to pay commissions to the Crown simply for the privilege of using the world's oceans. The Crown reaped billions in profits while operating under the protection of the British armed forces. This was not British commerce or British wealth, but the Crown's commerce and the Crown's wealth. As of 1850, author Frederick Morton estimated the Rothschilds' fortune to be in excess of $10 billion. Today, the combined wealth of the banking dynasties is estimated at around $500 trillion. Today, the bonded indebtedness of the world is held by the Crown. The aforementioned Temple Bar is the juristic arm of the Crown and holds an exclusive monopoly on global legal fraud through their bar association franchises. The Temple Bar is comprised of four Inns of Court. They are the Middle Temple, Inner Temple, Lincoln's Inn and Gray's Inn. The entry point to these closed secret societies is only to be found when one is called to their bar. The bar attorneys in the United States owe their allegiance and pledge their oaths to the Crown. All bar associations throughout the world are signatories and franchises to the International Bar Association located at the Inns of Court of the Crown Temple. The Inner Temple holds the legal system franchise by license that bleeds Canada and Great Britain white, while the Middle Temple has license to steal from America. To have the Declaration of Independence recognized internationally, Middle Templar King George III agreed in the Treaty of Paris of 1783 to establish the legal crown entity of the incorporated United States, referred to internally as the Crown Temple States, Colonies. States spelled with a capital letter S, denotes a legal entity of the Crown. At least five Templar bar attorneys under solemn oath to the Crown, signed the American Declaration of Independence. This means that both parties were agents of the Crown. There is no lawful effect when a party signs as both the first and second parties. The declaration was simply an internal memo circulating among private members of the Crown. Most Americans believe that they own their own land, but they have merely purchased real estate by contract. Upon fulfillment of the contract, control of the land is transferred by warranty deed. The warranty deed is only a color of title. Color of title is a semblance or appearance of title, but not title in fact or in law. The warranty deed cannot stand against the land patent. The Crown was granted land patents in North America by the King of England. Colonials rebelled at the usurious Crown taxes, and thus the Declaration of Independence was created to pacify the populace. Another ruse used to hoodwink natural persons is by enfranchisement. Those cards in your wallet bearing your name spelled in all capital letters means that you have been enfranchised and have the status of a corporation. A juristic personality has been created, and you have entered into multivariant agreements that place you in an equity relationship with the Crown. These invisible contracts include birth certificates, citizenship records, employment agreements, driver's licenses and bank accounts. It is perhaps helpful to note here that contracts do not now, nor have they ever had to be stated in writing in order to be enforceable by American judges. If it is written down, it is merely a written statement of the contract. Tax protesters and the coming draft resistors trying to renounce the parts of these contracts that they now disagree with will not profit by resorting to tort law, fairness, arguments as justification. Judges will reject these lines of defense as they have no bearing on contract law jurisprudence. Tort law governs grievances where no contract law is in effect. These private agreements, contracts that bind us, will always overrule the broad general clauses of the Constitution and Bill of Rights, the Constitution being essentially a renamed enactment of English common law. The Bill of Rights is viewed by the Crown as a bill of benefits, conferred on us by them in anticipation of reciprocity, taxes. Protesters and resistors will also lose their cases by boasting of citizenship status. Citizenship is another equity agreement that we have with the Crown. And this is the very juristic contract that federal judges will use to incarcerate them. In the words of former Supreme Court Justice Felix Frankfurter, equity is brutal, but we are merely enforcing agreements. The balance of Title 42, Section 1981 of the Civil Rights Code states, citizens shall be subject to like punishment, pains, penalties, taxes, licenses, and exactions of every kind. What we view as citizenship, the Crown views as a juristic enrichment instrumentality. It also should be borne in mind that even cursory circulation or commercial use of Federal Reserve notes affects an attachment of liability for the payment of the Crown's debt to the Fed. This is measured by your taxable income. And to facilitate future asset stripping, the end of the 14th Amendment includes a state of debt hypothecation of the United States, wherein all enfranchised persons, that's you, can be held personally liable for the Crown's debt. The Crown views our participation in these contracts of commercial equity as being voluntary, and that any gain accrued is taxable, as the gain wouldn't have been possible were it not for the Crown. They view the system of interstate banks as their own property. Any profit or gain experienced by anyone with a bank account, or loan, mortgage or credit card, carries with it, as an operation of law, the identical same full force and effect as if the Crown had created the gain. Bank accounts fall outside the umbrella of Fourth Amendment protection because a commercial contract is in effect and the Bill of Rights cannot be held to interfere with the execution of commercial contracts. The Crown also views bank account records as their own private property, pursuant to the bank contract that each of us signed and that none of us ever read. The rare individual who actually reads the bank contract will find that they agreed to be bound by Title 26 and under Section 7202 agreed not to disseminate any fraudulent tax advice. This written contract with the Crown also acknowledges that bank notes are taxable instruments of commerce. When we initially opened a bank account, another juristic personality was created. It is this personality, income and assets, that IRS agents are excising back to the Crown through taxation. A lot of ink is being spilled currently over Social Security. Possession of a Social Security number is known in the Crown's lax as conclusive evidence of our having accepted federal commercial benefits. This is another example of an equity relationship with the Crown. Presenting one's Social Security number to an employer seals our status as taxpayers, and gives rise to liability for a reciprocal quid pro quo payment of taxes to the Crown. Through the Social Security number, we are accepting future retirement endowment benefits. Social Security is a strange animal. If you die, your spouse gets nothing, but rather, what would have gone to you is divided, forfeited, among other premium payers who haven't died yet. But the Crown views failure to reciprocate in any of these equity attachments as an act of defilement and will proceed against us with all due prejudice. For a person to escape the tentacles of the Crown octopus, a thoroughgoing study of American jurisprudence is required. One would have to be deemed a stranger to the public trust, forfeit all enfranchisement benefits and close all bank accounts, among other things. Citizenship would have to be made null and forfeit, and the status of denizen enacted. If there are any persons extant who have passed through this fire, I would certainly appreciate hearing from them. The United States of America is a corporation, ruled by the British Crown and the Vatican. The USA is, and always has been, a huge corporation ruled from abroad. Its initial name was the Virginia Company, and it is owned by the British Crown and the Vatican, who receive their yearly share of the profits. The U.S. presidents are appointed CEOs, they are not elected by us, and their allegiance is to the board of directors, not to the American citizens. We are seen as employees of the company, and voting is designed as a distraction meant to offer us the illusion that we have a say in all this. In 1606, King James set up the Virginia Company, which was granted royal authority to begin settlements in the province of Virginia, named after Elizabeth I, who had been popularly called the Virgin Queen. The Union Jack first flew on American soil at Jamestown in Virginia as a permanent fixture in the spring of 1607. The early members of the Virginia Company were aristocrats who supported the Church of England and the Royalist cause. They included Lord Southampton, the Earl of Pembroke, the Earl of Montgomery, the Earl of Salisbury, the Earl of Northampton, and Sir Francis Bacon. As Chancellor of England, Bacon was able to persuade the king to issue the charters which enabled the new colonies to proliferate in the New World. The Virginia Company members who actually settled in America included several members of the Bacon family, and friends of his who were initiates of the Rosy Cross. Michael Howard, occult conspiracy, quoted by Michael Zarian, "I understand from contacts in America that it is through organizations like the London Metal Exchange that profits from the Virginia Company, United States of America, are channeled back to London." David Dickey's The Biggest Secret, "The House of Burgesses was formed in Jamestown in 1619. It was the first representative legislative body in the American colonies. The House passed measures designed to help the company prosper. But a serious Indian uprising in Jamestown in 1622 caused the adventurers to lose what little interest they had left. In 1623, King James decided that the company was being managed poorly. He took over the association in 1624 and dissolved the company. World Book Encyclopedia, its shareholders were Londoners, and it was distinguished from the Plymouth Company, which was chartered at the same time and composed largely of men from Plymouth. In 1619, the company established Continental America's first true legislature, the General Assembly, which was organized bilaterally. It consisted of the governor and his council, named by the company in England, and the House of Burgesses, made up of two burgesses from each of the four boroughs and seven plantations. The court ruled against the Virginia Company, which was then dissolved, with the result that Virginia was transformed into a royal colony. Encyclopedia Britannica, "This means that all the rights which applied to the owners of the Virginia Company to the gold, silver, minerals and duties, mined and paid in America, still apply to the British families who own the United States of America and the lands of the United States of America. Those same percentages have been paid since independence and are still being paid by the American people via their federal officials who are, in fact, officials of the Virginia Company, yes, including the president." But here's yet another twist. Who owns the assets apparently owned by the Virginia Company? Answer: the Vatican. David, The Biggest Secret, after the original 13, again, American colonies won their independence and an independent country was formed after 1783, the Virginia Company simply changed its name to the United States of America. You see, there are two USAs, or rather a USA and a USA. The United States of America with a lowercase u and s are the lands of the various states. These lands, as we have seen, are still owned by the British Crown as the head of the old Virginia Company, although there is something to add about this in a moment. Then there is the United States of America, capital U and S, which is the 68 square miles of land west of the Potomac River on which is built the federal capital, Washington, D.C. and the District of Columbia. It also includes the U.S. protectorates of Guam and Puerto Rico. The United States of America is not a country, it is a corporation owned by the same Brotherhood reptilian bloodlines who own the Virginia Company, because the USA is the Virginia Company. David K., The Biggest Secret. In 1604, a group of leading politicians, businessmen, merchants, manufacturers and bankers, met in Greenwich, then in the English county of Kent, and formed a corporation called the Virginia Company in anticipation of the imminent influx of white Europeans, mostly British at first, into the North American continent. Its main stockholder was the reptilian, King James I, and the original charter for the company was completed by April 10, 1606. This and later updates to the charter established the following : The Virginia Company comprised of two branches, the London Company and the Plymouth or New England Company. The pilgrims of American historical myth were, in fact, members of the Second Virginia Company branch called the New England Company. The Pilgrim Society is still a major elite grouping within the Illuminati. The Virginia Company owned most of the land of what we now call the USA, and any lands up to 900 miles offshore. This included Bermuda and most of what is now known as the Caribbean Islands. The Virginia Company, the British Crown and the bloodline families, had rights to 50%, yes 50%, of the ore of all gold and silver mined on its lands, plus percentages of other minerals and raw materials, and 5% of all profits from other ventures. These rights, the charters detailed, were to be passed on to all heirs of the owners of the Virginia Company and therefore continue to apply forever. The controlling members of the Virginia Company who were to enjoy these rights became known as the Treasurer and Company of Adventurers and Planters of the City of London. After the first 21 years from the formation of the Virginia Company, all duties, imposts, and excises paid on trading activities in the colonies had to be paid directly to the British Crown through the Crown Treasurer. The lands of the Virginia Company were granted to the colonies under a deed of trust, on lease, and therefore they could not claim ownership of the land. The monarch, through his council for the colonies, insisted that members of the colonies impose the Christian religion on all the people, including the Native Americans. The criminal courts on the lands of the Virginia Company were to be operated under admiralty law, the law of the sea, and the civil courts under common law, the law of the land. Now, get this. The entire above still applies today. David Icke's, The Biggest Secret, The United States Incorporated. England, Canada, Australia and many other countries are led politically by prime ministers to the Queen. In fact, she is the official head of 123 Commonwealth countries. America, Russia, and other countries, however, have a president and vice president. Usually corporations have presidents and vice presidents. What does this mean? The US presidents rule from the White House. The Russian presidents also rule from the White House. The Jesuits, a large force behind the Illuminati, have their own White House as well. England is ruled from Whitehall. The United States government is being ruled from the White House. The government of England is being ruled from what is called Whitehall, and Whitehall, like our White House, is the symbol of power because the hall is like the Masonic Hall, the Lodge Hall, the Union Hall. Jordan Maxwell, Matrix of Power. For those who think America controls the roost, it would do well to consider that the Queen of England is still the official head of Commonwealth, 123 countries, and the official monarch of Australia and Canada along with the United Kingdom. Add to that the fact that all Bush Sr. got for his two terms as President of USA is a mere knighthood of the British Empire. Prash Trivedi, the original 13 colonies were actually called companies. Military units are also called companies. We sing patriotic songs like the Star Spangled Banner, but a banner is a corporate advertisement, not a flag. You surrender with a white flag, no colors. When you get mad, you show your true colors. If you just won independence in a bloody revolution with Britain, would you choose the same three colors for your new US flag? Why does every heart ring true for the red, white, and blue? What about the gold-fringed flag used by the military, hung at all courts, schools, and government buildings? It all has to do with the British Maritime Admiralty Law of Flags. Barack Obama is the current CEO of the USA Corporation, and the gold-fringed flags in the background stand for ruled from abroad. This is also known as British Maritime Military Law, and this is why the American flag always has a gold fringe when displayed in the courts of the United States. You find the same in government buildings and federally funded schools. The gold fringe is a legal symbol indicating that the court is sitting under British maritime law and the Uniform Commercial Code, military and merchant law, not common or constitutional law. Under the Admiralty Law of Flags, the flag displayed gives notice of the law under which the ship, in this case the court, is regulated. Anyone entering that ship, court, accepts by doing so that they are submitting to the law indicated by that flag. Judges refuse to replace the flag with one without a fringe when asked by defendants who know the score, because that changes the law under which the court is sitting. If you appear in a court with a gold-fringed flag, your constitutional rights are suspended and you are being tried under British maritime, military/merchant law. David K. Tales from the Time Loop, International Maritime Admiralty Law, the Law of the High Seas, began in Zamuria, was perfected in Rome, and continues to this day. Jordan Maxwell has explained that the way we trade commerce today is modeled after the Masons/Templar Knights 1,000-year-old system. Notice how, regardless of whether you send a product by air, water, or land, you ship it. The ship pulls into its berth and ties to the dock. The captain has to provide the port authorities with a certificate of manifest declaring the products he has brought. Through a legal loophole the royals have created, U.S. citizens are considered property of the Queen under British maritime law. Since we are born of our mother's water, from her birth canal, we are thereby a maritime product, a shipped commodity. Our mothers were delivering a product under maritime law, and that's why we are born in a delivery room. That's why the dock signs your birth certificate, your certificate of manifest. You're kept in the maternity ward. Why a ward? No other hospital areas are called wards. Prisons have wards and wardens. The United States Corporation came about just after the Civil War. The Act of 1871 was passed by Congress, creating a separate form of government for D.C., essentially turning it into a corporation. It was decided that employees would be called citizens. So when you say in court or on paper that you are a citizen of the United States, you are not a free American, but an employee of U.S. Incorporated. When you get a fine, a ticket, a bill, or get sued, you must sign in all capital letters. When you die, your Masonic tombstone by law will have all capital letters to show their employee has died. The entity that is your name in all caps is your Maritime Admiralty Product Code. Upper and lower case legally represents you, your body. The Uniform Commercial Code was approved by the American Bar Association, which is a franchise, a subordinate branch, of the British legal system, and its hierarchy based in London's Temple Bar, named after the Illuminati Knights Templar Secret Society. As I have been writing for many years, the power that controls America is based in Britain and Europe, because that is where the power is located that owns the United States Corporation. By the way, if you think it is strange that a court on dry land could be administered under maritime law, look at U.S. Code, Title 18b7. It says that admiralty jurisdiction is applicable in the following locations: 1. The high seas, 2. Any American ship, 3. Any lands reserved or acquired for the use of the United States, and under the exclusive or concurrent jurisdiction thereof, or any place purchased or otherwise acquired by the United States by consent of the legislature of the state. In other words, mainland America. All this is founded on Roman law, because the Illuminati have been playing this same game throughout the centuries wherever they have gone. The major politicians know that this is how things are, and so do the government administrators, judges, lawyers, and insider journalists. Those who realize what is happening and ask the court for the name of the true creditor or recipients of the fines imposed by the legal system are always refused this information by the judge. The true creditors in such cases, and the ultimate recipient of the fines, are the bankers to which the corporation country is bankrupt. David K. Tales from the Time Loop. Lawyers or barristers have to take the Bar Association bar exam just as alcoholics go to the bar, sugar junkies eat candy bars, and gamblers hope to get 3 bars on the slot machine. These all derive from the Templars' turn of the 13th century Temple Bar in England. Originally, the Temple Bar was literally just a bar or chain between 2 posts next to the Temple Law Courts. This soon became a huge stone gate, and there were eventually 8 of these gates built so the elites could restrict, control trade within the City of London. They were taken down during 19th century, but then each stone was numbered and kept in storage until 2004, when they just rebuilt the Temple Bar in London. The United States Corporation was created behind the screen of a federal government when, after the manufactured victory in the American War of Independence, the British colonies exchanged overt dictatorship from London with the far more effective covert dictatorship that has been in place ever since. In effect, the Virginia Company, the corporation headed by the British Crown that controlled the former colonies, simply changed its name to the United States and other related pseudonyms. These include the US, USA, United States of America, Washington, D.C., District of Columbia, federal government, and feds. The United States Corporation is based in the District of Columbia, and the current president of the corporation is a man called George W. Bush. He is not the president of the people or the country as they are led to believe, that's just the smokescreen. This means that Bush launched a war on terrorism on behalf of a private corporation to further the goals of that corporation. It had nothing to do with America or Americans, because these are very different legal entities. It is the United States Corporation that owns the United States military and everything else that comes under the term federal. This includes the Federal Reserve, the central bank of the United States, which is, in reality, a private bank owned by controlling stockholders and controllers of the U.S. corporation that are not even American. This is the bank from which the United States Corporation borrows money. David K. Tales from the Time Loop, The Greater British Empire Map. The shocking truth about your birth certificate. If you notice, on the bottom of your birth certificate it says Department of Commerce. It is a property of the Department of Commerce because you are nothing more than a piece of commercial material. That's why if you're out of work you don't go to the unemployment office. You go to the Office of Human Resources, because you're just a human resource. Jordan Maxwell, 1990. Slideshow presentation on hidden symbols. The judge sits on the bench for the bank. Banks are on both sides of the river. A river bank directs the flow of the current, C, the currency, the cash flow. The currency is deposited from bank to bank down the river. We're just consumers to advertise to. Just human resources to be used up like batteries, and they are the social engineers, molding us useless eaters into wage slavery. Read the Atlantean conspiracy if you want to learn more. Pay commissions to the Crown simply for the privilege of using the world's oceans. The Crown reaped billions in profits while operating under the protection of the British armed forces. This was not British commerce or British wealth, but the Crown's commerce and the Crown's wealth. As of 1850, author Frederick Morton estimated the Rothschilds' fortune to be in excess of $10 billion. Today, the combined wealth of the banking dynasties is estimated at around $500 trillion. Today, the bonded indebtedness of the world is held by the Crown. The aforementioned Temple Bar is the juristic arm of the Crown and holds an exclusive monopoly on global legal fraud through their Bar Association franchises. The Temple Bar is comprised of 4 Inns of Court. They are, the Middle Temple, Inner Temple, Lincoln's Inn and Gray's Inn. The entry point to these closed secret societies is only to be found when one is called to their bar. The bar attorneys in the United States owe their allegiance and pledge their oaths to the Crown. All bar associations throughout the world are signatories and franchises to the International Bar Association located at the Inns of Court of the Crown Temple. The Inner Temple holds the legal system franchise by license that bleeds Canada and Great Britain white, while the Middle Temple has license to steal from America. to have the Declaration of Independence recognized internationally, and this is the very juristic contract that federal judges will use to incarcerate them. In the words of former Supreme Court Justice Felix Frankfurter, equity is brutal, but we are merely enforcing agreements. The balance of Title 42, Section 1981 of the Civil Rights Code states, citizens shall be subject to like punishment, pains, penalties, taxes, licenses, and exactions of every kind what we view as citizenship, the Crown views as a juristic enrichment instrumentality. It also should be borne in mind that even cursory circulation or commercial use of Federal Reserve notes affects an attachment of liability for the payment of the Crown's debt to the Fed. This is measured by your taxable income. And to facilitate future asset stripping, the end of the 14th Amendment includes a state of debt hypothecation of the United States, wherein all enfranchised persons, that's you, can be held personally liable for the Crown's debt. The Crown views our participation in these contracts of commercial equity as being voluntary and that any gain accrued is taxable, as the gain wouldn't have been possible were it not for the Crown. They view the system of interstate banks as their own property. Any profit or gain experienced by anyone with a bank account, or loan, mortgage or credit card, carries with it, as an operation of law, the idle Templar King George III agreed in the Treaty of Paris of 1783 to establish the legal crown entity of the incorporated United States, referred to internally as the Crown Temple States, Colonies. States spelled with a capital letter S, denotes a legal entity of the Crown. At least five Templar bar attorneys under solemn oath to the Crown, signed the American Declaration of Independence. This means that both parties were agents of the Crown. There is no lawful effect when a party signs as both the first and second parties. The declaration was simply an internal memo circulating among private members of the Crown. Most Americans believe that they own their own land, but they have merely purchased real estate by contract. Upon fulfillment of the contract, control of the land is transferred by warranty deed. The warranty deed is only a color of title. Color of title is a semblance or appearance of title, but not title in fact or in law. The warranty deed cannot stand against the land patent. The Crown was granted land patents in North America by the King of England. Colonials rebelled at the usurious Crown taxes, and thus the Declaration of Independence was created to pacify the populace. Another ruse used to hoodwink natural persons is by enfranchisement. Those cards in your wallet bearing your name spelled in all capital letters means that you have been enfranchised. The top of the pyramid, the Rothschilds, the Vatican and the British Crown rule the world. There are two operant crowns in England, one being Queen. Although extremely wealthy, the Queen functions largely in a ceremonial capacity and serves to deflect attention away from the other crown, who issues her marching orders through their control of the English Parliament. This other crown is comprised of a committee of 12 banks headed by the Bank of England, also known as the House of Rothschilds. They rule the world from the 677-acre, independent sovereign state known as the City of London, or simply the City. The City is not a part of England, just as Washington, D.C., is not a part of the USA. The City is referred to as the wealthiest square mile on earth and is presided over by a Lord Mayor who is appointed annually. When the Queen wishes to conduct business within the City, she is met by the Lord Mayor at Templar Bar, where she requests permission to enter this private, sovereign state. She then proceeds into the city walking several paces behind the mayor. Her entourage may not be clothed in anything other than service uniforms. In the 19th century, 90% of the world's trade was carried by British ships controlled by the Crown. The other 10% of ships had to and have the status of a corporation. A juristic personality has been created, and you have entered into multivariant agreements that place you in an equity relationship with the Crown. These invisible contracts include birth certificates, citizenship records, employment agreements, driver's licenses and bank accounts. It is perhaps helpful to note here that contracts do not now, nor have they ever had to be stated in writing in order to be enforceable by American judges. If it is written down, it is merely a written statement of the contract. Tax protesters and, the coming, draft resistors trying to renounce the parts of these contracts that they now disagree with will not profit by resorting to tort law, fairness, arguments as justification. Judges will reject these lines of defense as they have no bearing on contract law jurisprudence. Tort law governs grievances where no contract law is in effect. These private agreements, contracts that bind us, will always overrule the broad general clauses of the Constitution and Bill of Rights, the Constitution being essentially a renamed enactment of English common law. The Bill of Rights is viewed by the Crown as a bill of benefits, conferred on us by them in anticipation of reciprocity, taxes. Protesters and resistors will also lose their cases by boasting of citizenship status. Citizenship is another equity agreement that we have with the Crown.